الحمد لله، نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جازيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. أما بعد، الله سبحانه وتعالى tells us a lot about the Quran in the Quran itself. I'm going to pick some ayat to see how not only important but how central the Quran is for our life. Starting from the beginning of the Quran, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. This book, certainly, there is no doubt in it, is guidance to those who are righteous. Very straightforward, very simple statement. And the simple understanding is the Quran is guidance. But when you take it into a deeper understanding, you will find it has much more than this, what I would call short understanding, if you will. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ. There is no doubt. There is no suspicion about it. There is nothing abnormal. There is nothing incredible. There is nothing to doubt about this book. So the first part, the first sentence, is that this book is a confirmed book, authenticated by Allah. He is certifying his book. Allah is certifying his book. Do you know when you write a paper and you want to authenticate it, you normally would take it to a notary public, right? For the notary to authenticate your signature, not necessarily the content of what you have written, he cannot verify it. But whatever you write, you put your signature on it, he is signing on your signature, not here. Allah is the one who sent the book, and Allah is the one who is telling you this book is from him, therefore it is perfect. There is nothing missing, there is nothing wrong, there is nothing to doubt about the Quran. Now, it is a very significant statement. It's very significant. You know, when somebody sends you a letter, and this is the first letter he would send to you, and you've never seen his signature before, you want to make sure it is from him. So he puts his name and address on the envelope so that you know that the signature inside is from that person. Furthermore, you may call and say, is this letter from you? It has some strange stuff, right? Then if he confirms, then you have no way to question what is in the letter. At least the source is not in question. So Allah is telling us in this short ayah that this book is certified by the one who sent it down. Very few books, by the way, are certified by their authors, especially historic books. Historic books, especially books of religions. You cannot tell who is the author. Some may say, how come? We know that Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the authors of the Bibles or the Gospels, are the authors of the Gospels. That's what we have been told. But if you read early prints of those Gospels, you will see each one of them titled The Gospel According to Mark, The Gospel According to Matthew, Luke, John, The Letters of St. Paul, which means somebody collected this material because it's not signed by the author. It is signed according to means somebody did it, put it together, and somebody is attributing it to an author you could never verify who even he was. But definitely, the Christians would tell us that those are disciples of Isa alayhi salam. But those authors came 60-some years after the earliest writing of any gospel was about 60 years after Isa alayhi salam was ascended to heaven. So this could not be the same generation. It could not be. So the significance of Allah signing his own book, authorizing the credibility of the book, is meant to do what? For the Muslim, it is meant to do one thing that is very important and central in our faith. That you take the book for what it says, or do not read it and don't believe it. That's it. You either accept it, Allah sent it, Allah is telling us what it is and what it does, and describes the book for you. So you either accept his statement and accept his book or reject it. فَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيُؤْمِنْ وَمَنْ شَاءَ فَلْيَكْفُرْ. Let he who wills to believe, let him believe. And the one who doesn't want to believe, let him not believe. It's just a free choice issue. But once you accept it, you cannot then raise doubt about it. You cannot raise doubt, and you cannot accept raising doubts about the book that Allah has authenticated, authorized, and gave to us as a credible reference that we should believe in and follow. Why is this important? It is important because on this book, we are hanging our fate, our happiness in this life and in the hereafter. The Quran is not just a book of spiritual guidance. It does offer definitely spiritual guidance, but it offers a full, complete, and perfect way of life for those who want to live a perfect life, as perfect as humanly possible, because nothing that goes through our hands is perfect. Nothing that we do with our hands is perfect, including the most intimate endeavor, which is our own intention, the niyyah. You find that it is always blemished with something, unless you deliberately strive to purify your intention, it is never pure. So if intention is not pure, what about actions? Mind you, whenever we finish the prayer, which is the most frequent ibadah we do, after we finish, assalamu alaikum, assalamu alaikum, what else do we do right next? What do we say? We say, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Why is this? Have we sinned in the prayer? But because of it is imperfection, because we could never thank Allah to the degree he deserves to be thanked. We could never worship Allah as perfect as he deserves to be worshipped. And that's why Allah talks to us in two languages in the Quran. The language of perfection for those who keep aspiring, and the language of possibility for those who cannot go beyond certain levels because of putting limitations on themselves. So in the language of perfection, you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. Be observant of Allah, be mindful of Allah, as mindful as you owe it to Him. حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. This is the perfection. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Be observant of Allah, be mindful of Allah, as long as you can and as much as you can. Then in the second statement, Allah leaves it up to you to determine how much you can, and He knows how much you can. So it is inspiring, it is enticing, it is encouraging to go as perfect as you should, but it gives you the possibility for lapsing. We all lapse in everything we do. We are created to lapse. كل بني آدم خطاء وخير الخطائين التوابون. Every human being is bound to make mistakes. And the best of those who make mistakes are the ones who ask for forgiveness and repent. خير الخطائين التوابون. The best of those who are sinning are the ones who are repenting frequently. Mind this word. Tawab is not like ta'ib. Tawab means someone who repents frequently, regularly. He's always second guessing the perfection of what he does, the degree of authenticity, the intention beyond what he does, and how perfect his actions are in the eyes of Allah, not in his own eyes. So it forces us to think about what we do. So where Allah commands us to be observant of Allah, to be mindful of Allah, He tells us, you have one of two choices. The better choice, of course, is to keep striving to perfection, حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ, right? And the other one is to strive as much as Allah has given you the power to. And if you discover weakness in yourself in one aspect of your life or another, you seek to correct it. It is like driving a car that gives you one and the same problem every time you go on the road. You don't want to hear that noise every time. You want to treat this noise because you don't know what next. Right? The same. If my soul is running away from Allah by its own imperfections, then I need to fix it. How do I fix it? The Quran is a source that tells us how to fix ourselves, how to fix our intentions, how to improve how we reach out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it all boils down to this ayah. This ayah, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابِ. This book indeed has no doubt in it. In it is guidance. Then the rest of the ayah, هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, it doesn't say here, unless you stop in a different stop, and it will make it فِيهِ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, like it has guidance for those who are mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the better reading is to say, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, stop, هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. So هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, guidance for the mindful, goes to the book as a whole. And instead of saying, فِيهِ هُدًى, then what is the rest? When you say this book has guidance for the mindful, then what is the rest of the book? Fairy tales? Stories of the old? Parent-inherited stories? No. This is, the whole book is guidance. And that also brings us to the other ayah that describes our faith presented in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم. Today I have completed your religion for you. وأتممت عليكم نعمتي. And I have completed and perfected my bounty upon you. ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. So Islam is not what Muslims say. Islam is not what Muslims do. Islam is not our religion. Islam is the deen عند Allah, the deen of Allah, and He has blessed us by accepting Islam to be yours. So you get it from Allah, you must keep it as is. So you cannot play with the Quran, and you cannot present Islam with your own ideas. You cannot invent or reinvent what the Quran is saying by your own interpretation. You have to root your interpretation in the language, the text, and the context of the ayat you are talking about. Some of us pick one ayah or two and make Islam revolve around them, as if Allah did not reveal but this one or two ayahs. That is not how the Sahaba dealt with the Quran. The Sahaba took the Quran as a whole and took Islam as a whole, and all what they did is they submitted their will and their life and their resources to Allah through the following of His book. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. Guidance for those who are mindful of Allah. Let us not mistake what the ayah is saying. Some people raise a question, if it is hudan lil muttaqin, what about the rest? No, you need to understand the language. When it says hudan lil muttaqin, it means it guides humans, all humans, to reach to the level of al-muttaqin. It is like saying, if you want to go to Dar al-Hijra picnic on, where, what was it? Bluemont? Bluemont Park. If you want to join them, this is the map. Right? I'm not comparing, but I'm using as an example. So the Quran gives you the direction to reach to that level. To reach to that level, you need to follow the Quran. So you will find also, right next to this second ayah of Surah Al-Baqarah, الَّذِينَ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. This is the description. يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ means they are believers. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ, they establish prayer, right? وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ, they spend from whatever we have provided them. Very central traits and characteristics of any basic believer. So المتقون, when you get to break it down to its elements, you find it's actually referring to the believers. What about the disbelievers? Isn't this book meant to address the disbelievers? Yes, it does. It addresses all humanity. Right few lines after this, the same surah, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ اُعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمْ. O mankind, worship Allah, the one who created you and created those who came before you. So Allah is now not only talking about the muttaqin or the mu'mineen, He is addressing humanity as a whole. So this book, we know whom is it coming down for, whom does it help the most. It is those who believe and are mindful of Allah, and those who are not doubtful about the credibility of the book, the contents of the book, the guidance that Allah has placed in His book. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our heart to His book. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم tells us إن هذا القرآن طرفه بيد الله وطرفه بأيديكم. He describes it as a rope. In one end, it is held in the hands of Allah. In another end, it is held by you. You who believe in it, hold on to this book. And this is very vividly clear in the ayah of Surah Al Imran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. The ayah was just cited. وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Everyone should be holding to that rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Al-Baqarah, وَمَنْ يَعْتَصِمْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ هُدِيَ إِلَى صِرَاطٍ مُسْتَقِيمٍ. وَمَنْ يَعْتَصِمْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ فَمَنْ يَكْفُرْ بِالطَّاغُوتِ وَيُؤْمِن بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى. This is the ayah I want from Surah Al-Baqarah, that he who holds on to the knot of the rope, you know, when the rope has a knot and you hold your hand above the knot, it cannot slide, right? لَنْ فِصَامَ لَهَا. It's not going to unravel. So Allah is telling us in no uncertain terms that it is on us to hold on to the robe of Allah, which is the Quran, and to do it all of us together, to support each other, to hold on to that robe, so that we are all saved. The description of the Quran as a robe gives you the sense that it is like somebody who is throwing down a robe for you from above. You know, who throws a rope down to somebody down is like somebody either drowning in a well or in an ocean, right? Or is being offered a rope to save him or her from fire underneath them, so he will catch it and hold strong to it to save his life. Which means what? The minute you let loose the rope, the minute you let the rope go, you are letting yourself drown or burn whatever happens underneath you. So this is not something light, that we should look at the Quran as another book. When we have time, we read it. When we don't have time, we don't. When we get a chance to study, inshallah, 10 years from now, I will do it, as if we have the 10 years secured. The way it should be is, hold on to that robe the second you believe in it, and live with that hand holding tight to that robe. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all of us and give us the right understanding of this book. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt. Allahumma aqsim lana min khashyatika ma tahulu bi baynana wa bayna ma'asiyatik, ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا، غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.